Welcome, everybody. Today I will speak about intervention under autonomous underwater vehicles, a bit of history, a bit of what we are doing in our laboratory, and some new concepts that arised recently. So first, what are the typical intervention tasks that the underwater robots have to perform? So there are tasks like valve turning or connector plugging, hot stub insertion, removal, and non-destructive testing, as well as surface cleaning from marine growth. There is also the tasks of transportation, installation of underwater structures, and this jointly we can call inspection, maintenance, and repair, IMR. Apart from this, there is also a task of object recovery, search and recovery, like, for example, looking for a black box from a crashed plane. There are tasks in biology where we are interested in core sampling of the sea bottom or sampling biological organisms. There are geological tasks where we are interested in sampling rocks. So there is a lot of tasks where we need to interact with the environment. And today, all of these tasks are performed in majority is performed by divers or heavy workless ROVs. And this is, what are the problems with divers? The divers can only work until around 300 meters of depth. It's of course a very risky job. The operations are not easy to repeat if you want to keep monitoring something. They are prone to errors because humans are prone to errors, and they require long training of the divers. On the other hand, we have the world-class ROVs. The problem with world-class ROVs is that they are very big and heavy. They weigh around 4 or 5 tons, and they need a special ship to deploy. This what is called a dynamic positioning vessel, which can keep its position on the sea precisely because the ROV is all the time tethered to the ship, so it cannot drift. It also means that because the ROVs are so heavy, the ship needs to have a sophisticated launch and recovery system. And as I said, it needs a tether. Tether means that we also need a tether management system, which is another part of the system. It can be a vehicle which has a winch. So, and this tether and the tether management system are prone to failures because of underwater connections, which are made by slip rings. Also, operations of this kind of systems highly depend on weather conditions, and the costs of operating world-class ROVs is prohibitively high. It's not really possible to use them for any events that are not giving, like these are not really important, or they are not giving a lot of income. So they are not possible to use for when especially when it's needed to do some operations quick, when they are needed in outside the oil and gas industry. So what is the solution? The solution is to use autonomous underwater vehicles capable of performing intervention, which will not require special ships to deploy, and that will not require tether management systems. And the only problem with this is that they don't really exist yet. This is a video which shows where the industry might be going. Yes, so this is a concept of one of the companies. Here we can see a system where we have a permanent deployment on the sea bottom. There is there are vehicles which have a docking station. They stay all the time on the bottom. They can work in two modes, as ROV or AUV. So they can work in a tethered mode, or they can work without the tether, depending on the mission. They are charging on the bottom. And depending on the task, they can perform tasks autonomously or in an ROV mode. And everything is controlled from an offshore office. This video shows different modes of operation, where, for example, here we have inspection in AUV mode, autonomous charging, the data is uploaded to the offshore. Here we have some operations of the valve turning. And here we have some emergency operations where there is a leak from the manifold, and wow. Yeah, and the AUV goes to see what's happened. The action is consulted in the offshore, and then some valve is closed to stop the leak, and the new part is installed in place of the broken part. So this picture shows what is needed especially in the IMR. Because this is the largest part of the intervention of underwater vehicles. So in IMR we have different tasks which are either intervention or not intervention, but for example, we have valve turning and hot stop insertion, where we need to develop some technologies. And some of these technologies we have already demonstrated in our lab. Some of these technologies are still a work in progress, and some of them are something that we have planned. So, for example, in valve turning and hot stop insertion, we have presented some motion planning. We have presented real-time control of autonomous valve turning. We have presented some obstacle avoidance. We have presented a scanning with a laser. We have also presented some force control. Next is pipe chain inspection. Here we are interested in using multimodal sensors, so sonars and vision sensors, to inspect pipes or cables. We have also shown this. We also are interested in operating the manifolds. So here we need to make a survey of the structure, optical or acoustic survey. We need to do some view planning, how to get the interesting parts of the structure in high resolution. And then we do the intervention. And then there is the part which is the most unexplored is the cooperative manipulation of multiple vehicles, where we are now starting to work on transportation of objects. So a bit of history. first works about underwater vehicles started from Odin. It was a vehicle which was mainly built to study control. It's a sphere, so it's hydrodynamic. Hydrodynamics are easy to describe. Next, there was the vehicle called Otter. There was some study about cooperative control between vehicle and arm, but it was in a very early phase. Then we had the Project Union. Again, the idea was that there will be a vehicle with an arm, but the components were only tested separately, and it was mostly focused on software architecture. And then we had a project called Amadeus. In Amadeus, again, different components and technologies for underwater intervention were developed. There was a dexterous three-finger gripper. There was a cell with two robotic arms, but all of this was separated. So this is like a core development of core technologies that happened at the beginning of the of research in underwater autonomous underwater intervention. Then we had the first project where there were actually some field trials, and this project is called Swimmer. The idea was that we have a shuttle. We have an AUV, which is a shuttle carrying an ROV. And this AUV is deployed from a ship. It goes autonomously to a docking station at the bottom, which is permanently installed. And when it goes to the docking station, it connects with the docking station. It has a wet mateable connector to connect to a link, which is the link goes to the shore through a permanent tether. And when it docks to the docking station, it releases an ROV, which is tethered to the AUV. And this ROV performs some intervention tasks, then comes back to the AUV, and the AUV surfaces. Then we had a project called Alive, where the idea was to use a vehicle equipped with two arms, for grasping and one arm for manipulation. And in this project, the vehicle was docking to a panel with holding it with the two arms and manipulating the valves. So it was a fixed-based manipulation. Then the first project where we had some floating-based manipulation was Sauvim, a big AUV with an arm, which was supposed to find and recover an object from the bottom. And then we had projects which where our lab was involved mostly in our lab from Girona. And here you can see Girona 500, our main vehicle. So these were projects Trident, Triton, and Pandora. All of them were similar. Trident was about recovering search and recovery of objects from the bottom. Triton also, it was a Spanish project, and Pandora about, for example, valve turning. And this is the, as I said, the actual experimental results in IAUV operation. Next, we have the, I will show how, yeah. So the first milestone project milestone project was Alive, the project where the AUV docked into an underwater panel and operated a valve. That was the vehicle. I can run. It's a bit long. Yeah, here is the interesting part where you can see the conditions down there. And the vehicle trying to dock to the panel to hold it. And then it will start manipulating the valve. Right. It deploys an arm and rotates the valve. Next project, as I said, it was SAUVIM, which has demonstrated first floating base manipulation. And in this project, first the AUV is searching for the object using acoustics. And then the arm is deployed, and it's picking the object with the arm. Then we have the Trident project. Trident project was a combination of different tasks. It was a multi-purpose object search and recovery strategy, where first there was a photo mosaic of the bottom built by the vehicle. Then when the object was localized, the object was recovered by the vehicle. So we can see here the photo mosaicing. Here we can see Girona 500 with a manipulator, with a 7 degrees of freedom arm, and a specially designed gripper for taking the black box. The black box is detected with a stereo camera. Yeah, the object is picked up and the vehicle is rising to the surface. This was the team. Okay, the next project was a Spanish project where the idea was that the AUV will be docking to a docking station and then The idea is that the AUV docks to a specially designed docking station where there are funnels, and the AUV has some rods which go into the funnels to stabilize it and to connect. And then it performs a fixed base manipulation of a valve and plugging and unplugging of a connector. These are the trials in the sea, in the port. So as you can see, visual detection, turning the valve. In this case, Girona 500 is equipped with a 4 degrees of freedom manipulator. From ECA. Here we have unplugging and plugging the connector. Then there was a work in Pandora project. Pandora project was about valve turning. One of the things was the valve turning. It was done in two different ways in our lab. First by Arnau Carrera, who did it with learning by demonstration, and then I worked on realizing the same task using task priority algorithm, and this is my work. Here we have our tank, our test tank, and a panel, underwater panel with four valves. The panel is detected using vision, and when after detection, a plan of intervention is built. It consists of a few set points where first the vehicle stops before the panel, then it goes to the first valve, it approaches the valve, it rotates the valve, and then it goes to other valves and rotates them by the desired angle. This was all done with task priority control, and this was one continuous experiment. I just had to cut it a bit to make it faster. So here we can see completely floating manipulation. Then it switches to the next. And next valve, and it goes back. Again, we are using a 4 degrees of freedom manipulator that we have installed on our IUV, and a fixed gripper, which was shaped to make the valve lock in it. So this was the history. What I consider history is more than 3 years ago. So these are the projects that happened in more or less last 3 years now, the most recent projects. And here we have to mention first Mari's project, where the idea was cooperative transportation, which I said is one of the big challenges now. But the trials, the experimental trials, were actually performed only with one vehicle. The cooperative transportation was simulated. And in this project, the vehicle was taking a pipe with a specially designed gripper. Then we have a Dextrov project. Dextrov was a combination of different technologies. The main idea was about controlling an ROV through a satellite link, where the crew is sitting on offshore, and the ship is used as a satellite link to a vehicle, which can be an AUV or ROV, or it's like an HROV, actually, because it does some things autonomously, some things are teleoperated, but the concept was that there is a large delay in satellite communication, so the vehicle had to perform some actions autonomously because it was not possible to control it like live teleoperation. Then there was a project in our lab which was about recovering objects. It was about cooperation of vehicles and recovering objects from the bottom. The cooperation was between a surface vehicle and two underwater vehicles. The surface vehicle was supposed to make a survey of the place to find where is the target. Then the ROV, the AUV, the both AUVs were supposed to cooperate in picking the target from the bottom, and one AUV was Girona 500 equipped with a 4 degrees of freedom manipulator, and using a laser scanner, it was building a point cloud where the thing that was supposed to be taken, it was recognized in the laser scan. And there was a sparrows going around Girona to give like a second view on the scene. Then there was my work during my Marie Curie, which the idea of the work was to use compliant control in underwater manipulation and to perform something like NDT testing. It was one of the ideas, was to do NDT testing. The AUV, here the AUV has to approach the pipe and touch it and keep some force to on the surface of the pipe. I will explain later more. So next thing is in our lab was the PhD thesis of Dina Joachim, where we which was about motion planning of the vector manipulator system, and moreover, it was motion planning in unknown environment, which was discovered with a laser scanner. And one of the recent works was a master thesis by Roger P, who did some preliminary experiments in dual arm manipulation. And the project that we are working now on is again about cooperative transportation. So it's the idea from Maris, but we are trying to realize it in experimental trials. So here we have the Merbots project. As you can see, we have Girona 500. With a laser scanner, building the model of the scene, detecting the object to manipulate, and Sparrows on the right side, giving a second view on the scene. It's one of the phases of the experiment because, as I said, there are three vehicles cooperating, but of course in the pool it doesn't make much sense to use the surface vehicle. So here we have the object pickup. Next is the project which I was realizing during my Marie Curie. It's the force control in underwater floating base manipulation. So as I said, the AUV is approaching a pipe, it's touching the pipe, and using a force torque sensor built in the manipulator wrist, it's trying to follow a trajectory on a pipe, at the same time keeping a force at desired level. A force normal to the pipe at the desired level. Of course, it's very problematic to keep the force because of the noise introduced by the thrusters. It depends very much on how the end effector is actually designed, how the probe is designed, what is the material, and all of these things, because if there is too much friction, it's a problem. If there is too much, if it's too soft, there is a problem. So in the end, I ended up with a hard tip with a cylinder at the end, which was sliding well on the surface, but for this experiment. And this was using task priority combined with admittance control. So it basically plans a trajectory. There is a trajectory planned on the pipe based on the detection of the pipe where it is supposed to go a bit inside the pipe, and the compliant control, based on the force readings, deforms the plan so that you can achieve the desired force, contact force, and follow the plan on the follow the a path on the real pipe. Then this is the experiment of Dina Joachim, where the idea was to first, here we are localizing. Here we are localizing the pipe to have it to have the model as a reference in Arvis. So it's an exploration which is detecting the pipe, and then we start the actual. It's all planned. So as you can see, there are different plans where the UV moves around to detect the pipe. Based on the markers, it's put in the in Arvis, and then actually the it was like a something we had to do before really starting the actual experiment, because the actual experiment is not about detecting the pipe with markers. It's about scanning it with the laser and detecting it online. So here you can see that the laser is started, and it's now it's moving to some starting position, and now it plans some trajectory, but in the meantime the laser detects the pipe, so it has to replan the motion. It's planning both the UV motion and the arm motion, but the algorithm is quite clever. It's checking what is best in every situation, so it's either planning to move the base or it's either planning to move the manipulator. So the AUV goes around, and here we have a valve where, as you can see, the AUV has to be close to the structure, but it cannot hit it, so the planning is really needed here to keep the AUV in a specific position. And then the last part is visual servoing used for valve turning. So we are using color to detect the valve. We are using some line and circle fitting to detect the center of the center of the valve, and we are approaching and turning the valve. All of this happened autonomously, of course, from the beginning till the end. And the last thing, that's the last experimental thing that happened in the lab is, I was saying, the master thesis of one of the students. He put two arms on Girona 500, I will hold 4 degrees of freedom arm, and another small arm connected with a pan tilt system, which formed like a 6 degrees of freedom arm. And with these two arms, he was trying to pick up the pipe that you see on the right side. And as I was saying, the last thing that is happening now in the lab is the TwinBot project. And in December, we are supposed to present first experimental trials in cooperative transportation. There will be two Gironas. There will be Girona 500, and in the end there will be a Girona 1000, which is now being built. And both of them will be equipped with 4 degrees of freedom manipulators and gripper designed for this task. And the idea is to pick up the pipe and do some maneuver with it. Probably first just transport it forward or up or some simple movement. Then we want to rotate the pipe around, for example, and put it back. And here the strategy is still under development, but probably one of the vehicles will be a leader and the second one will be following, and we'll try to use the force sensor to use some compliancy, and also we'll try to we'll plan the path of the pipe, and then both vehicles will try to follow the plan. But the, because of the control systems of the vehicles, they are always moving, and to minimize the stress on the manipulators, we will use the force sensors, as I said, to use some compliant control. Okay. And here I just wanted to show some of the things that happened recently, some ideas from other than typical AUV, for example, like the robot from Stanford, which is like an underwater avatar, where the person is sitting, the person is still operating it with the haptic devices. Then we have a concept from Houston Mechatronics, which is a company. Yes, the idea here is that this is a transformer, so this AUV, where is the transform part? I'm sorry. And so the idea is that the vehicle can work as an AUV, but then it transforms into an IAUV. It takes out the arms and it can perform some manipulation. And the vehicle is already built and it's tested now in the NASA Space Center. And the last idea is the most unusual one, which was developed by Illum, a company which is a startup of NTNU, which is an underwater snake robot. Of course, it's a completely different concept, but an interesting concept where a very small robot can reach small spaces, can it's supposed to live underwater. And it can also manipulate, as you can see. Holding to the panel, interesting idea. Yes, okay. Thank you very much. This is the end of my presentation. I hope it was interesting.